I think we're ready to go. Is everybody ready? Are we live yet?
Is everybody ready?
Yes.
Ready.
Hey, Sean, can you...
The day of the meeting is not correct. Isn't this December 2nd today?
Yes.
Oh, you're right.
I think it is. I hope so.
Go to the next slide.
I have a reason I know that, which I'll explain later.
Is it your birthday?
No. Just stay tuned.
Wow, look at that.
Are we live?
We are live.
Okay, good. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and Capitol residents. Welcome to the December 2nd Planning Commission. And tonight, as usual, will be broadcast on Charter Communications Cable TV Channel 8 and AT&T U-verse Channel 99. Our technician tonight is Walter. And if you care to participate on any of the agenda items or during our communications, if you look at your screen, you'll see now there's many ways you can by calling in, joining the webinar, and we'd love to have you join in if you have anything to add to our meeting. So with that, we have the roll call, please, Chloe.
Yes. Commissioner Christensen.
Here.
Commissioner Newman.
Here.
Commissioner Westman.
Here.
Commissioner Wilk.
Here.
Chair Ruth.
Here.
Thank you.
Please stand, Pledge of Allegiance.
Looks like we might have lost the chair roof.
Peter, would you, or Commissioner Wolf, would you mind sharing it till he, oh no, here it comes. Let's see. Chair Ruth, you're on mute.
You're muted.
You seem to have a little bit of a connection issue earlier. Chair Ruth, you're on mute.
There we go. I lost connection.
It may help to turn off your video if you're having difficulty with your connection.
Okay. Got that straightened out. So that brings us to item 2 on our agenda tonight, which is oral communications. Our first part of that is additions and deletions to the agenda. Katie, do we have any of those?
We did receive one additional public comment on item 4B, 109 Sacramento Avenue, from a neighbor in support of that project. And I came to your email today.
Yeah, I've seen that. Hopefully everybody does. She supports the deck. Okay. Any public comments? Now is the time for members of the public for addressing items of concern that are not on the agenda tonight. So we'll give you a little bit of time here to weigh in if you have anything to add to the meeting tonight. Okay.
seeing any hands raised from panelists.
Okay, we'll continue on then. And go to item C, which is commission comments. Any commissioners have any things they'd like to address tonight? Hearing no one, we'll move on to staff comments. Katie, any staff comments?
Yes, I do have a few staff comments. So first, Olivia, would you mind, I wanted to introduce you to Olivia Bear, so you can see her in your screen. Olivia Bear reached out to me during the pandemic and asked if we had any internships available when she was at UC Santa Barbara last year. So I had the pleasure of working with Olivia. She did a study remotely for the city on sea level rise and what other communities are doing to update their LCPs. And she put together a great paper for me just outlining where other communities are in the process, very informative, what they've been adding to their codes and what the Coastal Commission has had them add to their codes. We have some really great research paper that Olivia put together. And Olivia, this past summer, or last spring, graduated from Santa Barbara, and she is a local. She lives in Aptos, and her family has ownership of a very popular business here in the city of Capitola, and is very well rooted here. And I reached out to her when we were short staffed and said, would you like another opportunity to come into our office and start helping with the day-to-day work within our office? So Olivia has been such an asset to Sean and I over the past three months at this point, helping out with the day-to-day planning and admin responsibilities. And I just wanted to let you all know, introduce Olivia and let you know what she's been doing behind the scenes. She was recently offered a position in San Diego, so she will be leaving us. She is headed down there in January. But just really wanted to give my thanks for all her hard work here and let you all know who's been helping us out behind the scenes. I think I know Sean and I talk about how much we're going to miss her already, so she's just been a great asset to our team. So thank you, Olivia, and we wish you the best. She'll be here through the end of the year. Do you have anything you want to add, Olivia?
No, just it's been a great experience learning a ton, so thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. You've picked the second best place in the state to land.
Yeah, we've had great success with interns. Peter knows well from having his daughter Joanna was an intern here, and then we got a great planning commissioner out of that internship, and she moved on to work over the hill. And then, of course, Sean Sasanto started off as an intern, and we were so lucky to be able to keep him on staff. So, anyways, so that's my first update, and thank you, Olivia.
She ended up working for Rich Bruno down there?
Not for Rich Bruno. He'll be close by.
Okay, just wondering.
The second update I have for you tonight is last night the City Council did accepted the first reading of the ordinance for the outdoor dining. They took all of the Planning Commission changes to the ordinance other than the locations, and they kept sidewalk dining in the ordinance. So the sidewalk dining stayed in the ordinance. They allowed sidewalk dining. They added Capitola Avenue to the list of sidewalk dining locations. And then they brought back the street dining decks on Monterey Avenue and Capitola Avenue. But during their deliberations, they all gave a sincere thanks to the Planning Commission. There were all the rest of your changes made it into the ordinance. They recognized the hard work and they understood the need to do this right, but they did want to move the ordinance forward so they could have something permanent, hopefully this summer, starting for that three-year trial. So again, there are thanks and appreciation for all your hard work on that. And if you have any questions, feel free to contact me and we can talk through any of that. And lastly, the city council, they updated their, recently, two meetings ago, they updated the reimbursement policy for digital reading devices. I'm going to send that to you via email, so you'll have an updated version of that and just know if you're ready. Now that we're so dependent on our technology for these meetings, budget has gone up and it has a little more flexibility included. So I'll be sending that to you through email and let me know if you'd like to utilize any of those funds. So that's there for you. And with that concludes my staff comments.
Okay, thank you, Katie. So that brings us to item three tonight, the approval of the minutes. We have two meetings that we have to address. I think we'll probably take them separately. The first meeting is October 7th of 2021, the minutes from that meeting. Is there a motion to approve any additions or corrections?
I'll make a motion to approve.
Okay, we have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second it, Commissioner Wilkes.
We have a motion and a second. The second by Commissioner Wilkes. Mary, the roll call, please, Chloe.
Commissioner Christensen.
Aye.
Commissioner Newman.
Aye.
Commissioner Westman.
Aye.
Commissioner Wilk.
Aye.
Chair Ruth.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, those minutes are approved, and the second set of minutes is from the meeting of November 4th. Is there a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved, Commissioner Wilk.
I'll second.
Okay, Commissioner Christensen second. May I have the roll call, please, again, Chloe?
Commissioner Christensen.
Aye.
Commissioner Newman.
Aye.
Commissioner Westman.
Aye.
Commissioner Wilk.
Aye.
Chair Ruth.
Aye. So the minutes are approved. That brings us to item four tonight, the consent calendar. We have three items on the consent calendar tonight. One of them is calling for a continuation. Would there be a motion to approve, or does anybody want to pull any items for discussion?
No one wants to pull anything, I'll make a motion to approve it.
Okay. Is there a second to approve the consent calendar?
I'll second it, Commissioner Wilk.
By Commissioner Wilk. Roll call, please, Chloe.
Commissioner Christensen.
Aye.
Commissioner Newman.
Aye.
Commissioner Westman.
Aye.
Commissioner Wilk.
Aye.
Chair Ruth.
Aye. Okay, that brings us to item five, our public hearings. We have two tonight. And the first public hearing is, I think, just an overview of the new state of California housing legislation, which there seems to be a lot of lately, and the community development housing work plan. Katie, is this going to be you or Sean?
This is actually, I'd like to introduce Layla.
Layla, okay.
Yeah. From our attorney's office, they let me give an update of the recent legislation, and I will tune in at the end. I'll chime in at the end to talk about our work plan.
Okay. Layla?
Hi, good evening, Chair Ruth, commissioners, staff. Pleasure to see you all over Zoom that week. My name is Layla Moore-Trafenet. I'm the senior associate with Kirk Williams and Thornton, so I have the pleasure of working with Sam Butler on a regular basis, who you may know. I'm going to be sharing my screen right now, but I think it looks like, I'm not sure who's sharing right now, but okay, I should be able to do it now. Okay, perfect, great. Now you can see that, and I will go to the presentation. Okay, can everyone see the presentation okay?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful. Okay. So
Layla?
Yeah.
Before you start, I just want to make it clear. I think there's a few that everything that was on the consent calendar, I just want to make it clear to the public that everything that was on consent passed this evening. So if you had an item on consent that's passed, you're welcome to continue to attend the meeting. So I just want to make sure that's clear. Thank you.
All right, so as you're all probably aware, there's been a lot of activity in the state legislature this year, has been no exception, particularly related to housing in California, which continues to be sort of the evergreen popular topic to pass new, exciting, and sometimes nerve-wracking legislation. So tonight we're gonna just be talking about some of the heavy hitters, we'll call them, in the latest batch of housing legislation. First, we'll talk about SB 9, which involves the ministerial approval of two-unit and lot split development. There is also some streamlining updates from SB 8 and SB 10. And then lastly, the bill that kind of does a little bit with our housing element in terms of our timeline and things that we need to look out for, and that's AB 1398. So starting off with this year's most popular topic of discussion, at least related to housing, is SB 9, which is the two-unit and lot split legislation. And what SB 9 does essentially is it provides for the ministerial approval of up to two units on a single lot. And in addition, the other part of SB 9 also allows for the creation of two lots, essentially a lot split. Now, this has created somewhat of a panic in a lot of places throughout the state, you know, thinking about, is this the end of, you know, single family housing? What does this mean? How is this implemented? And the answer is, overall, it's probably not going to have as much of an effect as folks are anticipating right now. However, and so one of the big reasons for that is currently as drafted, SB 9 would apply, for example, in Capitola to the R1 zone only. And this is because the current interpretation of SB 9 and I should frame this with a slight caveat that could be subject to change pending updated HUC update or guidelines, HCD guidelines. But as of now, at least, the SB 9 will only apply to zones that are currently designated for single family and that do not currently have or allow for multi-family development. So again, in Capitola, we're just talking about the R1 zone. Now, we still can apply also, even though there's a ministerial approval process, that doesn't eliminate the possibility of applying local development standards. And these include setbacks of up to 4 feet, up to one parking space per unit, although zero parking would be allowed, or would be allowed to be required if we're near major transit. We must require that rentals are longer than 30 days, and we have to allow for a minimum of 800 square feet. The city can't deny SB 9 project if the project would have a specific adverse impact on health and safety or the physical environment, and that there's no reasonable, feasible way to kind of mitigate those impacts. So SB 9 is all about objective standards. What does an objective standard mean? Well, basically, it means that you have no personal or subjective judgment by a public official, and that it's uniformly verifiable by reference to an external and uniform benchmark or criterion available and knowable by the development applicant or proponent and the public official. And that's basically a long-winded way of describing a check. So one way, good way to think about objective standards or ministerial approval process is whether or not you can have a checklist, and if folks meet that checklist, then, you know, the project gets approved. And if they don't, then they don't. So some examples of objective standards include height, setbacks, lot coverage, percentage of open space, density, SAR, etc. So when we look at, we can ask ourselves, you know, how would a new single-family home in the R1 zone, which requires a design permit from the Planning Commission, be reviewed in the new year? Because that's kind of what we're looking at primarily, is R1 zone, how are single-family homes going to be looked at under SB9? Well, SB9 allows for up to two homes per lot. It doesn't specify that there has to be two. So potentially one home would also be subject to the ministerial approvals of SB9. Therefore, we would only be applying objective development and design standards, again, height, setbacks, floor area ratio, one parking space per unit, and we would not be able to apply discretionary criteria, which is most of our current design permit criteria. Things like protecting privacy or being compatible with the neighborhood look and feel. So again, we want to ensure that we are applying an objective checklist to these applications as opposed to qualitative standards. Some examples of standards that are found that have been found by the courts to not be effective include things like special care shall be taken to avoid obstructing views, produce high quality authentic design, reflect the look and feel of the community, or even the map subdivision map act finding that the site is not physically suitable for the proposed development. Anything that requires that kind of judgment. Or has that kind of fuzzy language that requires a judgment call or discretion, takes you out of objectiveness. Some additional SB9 requirements that are specific to the lot split aspect, and I can kind of quickly go through them and talk about them more in detail if you'd like. Essentially, the lots have to be roughly an equal size. You can't have a giant lot on one side and a small, tiny little corner on the other, and no smaller than 1,200 square feet. Other than the qualitative requirements in the Subdivision Map Act, it does need to comply with all other requirements. And it requires that the standards imposed can't preclude the construction of two units on either of the split parcels, or result in a unit size of less than 800 square feet. Allows requirements, custom code requirements for easements and right-of-way. So for example, if we have a flag lot, we can require access to the house in the back or the lot in the back. Requires owner occupancy of one unit for a minimum of 3 years from the date of approval, and this is achieved by an affidavit. And it also prohibits more than two units on parcels that are already subdivided through an urban lot split, such as junior ADUs, and primary dwelling units. So I think there was some concern at one point where that folks would, build a second unit, do a lot split, throw a couple of ADUs, and you would have, a city, essentially, a waste city one lot. But that's not that necessarily the case. And then lastly, adopting an SB9 local ordinance, which is advisable, is exempt from CEQA. So we are recommending that we go ahead and update the municipal code to implement SB9 locally. This will allow us to implement our own application review process, as well as objective development and design standards that fit with the city of Capitola and our goals. So next, we'll move on to SB8. SB8 essentially extends the time of the Housing Crisis Act, or SB 330, from 2025 to 2030, so 5-year extension. It's also specific to the topic of permit streamlining as related to affordable housing projects. So it allows for a preliminary review and also your maximum of 5 hearings on those affordable housing projects. It also modifies the relocation assistance requirements to help ensure that if you have affordable housing, you're replacing it, and also that there is a right of first refusal for folks who have been displaced by new construction. And it also updates some of the definitions, but we don't have to necessarily go into that tonight. We don't need to really do any municipal updates for SB8. There will just probably be increased tracking of development applications to make sure that we're complying with the streamlining and the timing. And SB10. So these are, again, streamlined opportunities, and this time for upstepping. So SB9 is a completely permissive bill. So it allows the city to adopt an ordinance authorizing housing development projects of 10 or fewer units per parcel in transit-rich areas or urban infill sites. And it essentially makes it easier for cities to upzone and to increase density in certain areas, provided that those areas match the requirements of the legislation, which includes that the parcel cannot be located in a very high fire hazard severity zone, or is subject to a voter approved restriction designating open space, parks, recreational purposes. And one of the, so city council or the city of Capitola has the option of creating such an upzoning ordinance to kind of streamline this process. And then lastly, we'll talk about AB 1398, which goes a little bit into the housing element and one of our favorite topics of RENA numbers.
Layla?
Yeah.
Before you go on, I was just going to advise you at the top of your screen where it says display settings.
Yeah.
I think if you click on that, there might be an option to duplicate or.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then it should, right now it's showing your notes and. So if you try pressing duplicate and see if that will.
Oh, okay.
There you go. Much
okay.
better.
Okay.
Yep. Thank
okay.
you. Yes.
Okay. So, So essentially, so we know RENA is all about identifying housing sites or sites to accommodate housing, and this is all part of our housing element update, and. Essentially, if we cannot identify enough sites to accommodate RENA, then we have to use our housing element to identify specific sites for rezoning in order to create those housing opportunities to satisfy the RENA obligation. So the necessary rezoning needs to be done within 3 years, which is faster than normal. Usually it's 5 to 6 years. But it can be up to 4 years if you have certain findings that are made, and the time is reduced to 1 year if the housing element is adopted late or not certified on time. So rezoned sites must allow housing development with 20% lower income housing as a permitted use, and there's no CEQA review for that, and again, we're limited to those objective design standards. So in terms of next steps, we're going to be, and Katie's going to talk a little bit more about this in detail, but we'll be continuing to work on updating the housing element to achieve HCD certification by December 2023, and we'll need to ensure that we have city council adoption of the housing element within 120 days of the December 31st, 2023 deadline. Or we run into, the rezoning issues. So yeah, just to conclude, if you haven't already noticed, there's definitely some overarching trends which are leaning heavily towards multifamily residential friendly legislation, and this is only expected to increase over the next several years. The inventory of housing continues to be not meeting the demand, as everyone I'm sure is well aware. And so there will probably continue to be these movements toward making it easier or even forcing local jurisdictions to allow for these greater density development projects. And, it kind of goes into affordability with low supply, high demand, housing prices are pretty high. It goes to inventory and it goes to equity as, in terms of, folks being able to access and have housing. And that kind of wraps up my portion of the presentation. And then, Katie, I'll turn it over to you.
Great. Can you go to the next slide, please?
Yes. Is this,
I think there's a timeline. There's two slides.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. So first, I just want to thank you, Layla. That was a great presentation. Right after we adopt a new zoning code, you know what comes next, right? The state having us do it again. So we'll be jumping into this in the new year. And I just wanted to also update you with the discussion on the housing element. We were expecting our RENA numbers to go up by 3 to 4 times their current amount. So at a little, I think we're at 160, more or less. I was expecting the numbers to come in somewhere between 450 and 600 in the new update. At the last AMBAG meeting that we had early this week, the previous meeting, the Capitola number was a little over 700. And at the last meeting, as we're looking at, typically we've looked at jobs and transit, the new requirements, we're now looking at resiliency. So wildfire, areas that are susceptible to wildfire will get less, and sea level rise. So that helps Capitola a little bit, bring down the number. But we're also looking at equity, and equity is a large number within the current calculations. And less diverse cities, their numbers will go up in terms of AMBAC, so, or in terms of RENA numbers. So currently with the draft calculations, which the board will be looking at next week, we're now at 1,090 units of New Capitola. So, there's more work to be done. In those considerations, they haven't really taken into consideration how small the city of Capitola is compared to our other jurisdictions. I expect that the number will decrease, but just that we've got our work cut out for us, and that's why I wanted to bring this forward so that nobody's surprised. But we'll be putting out an RFP for the housing element update in January. So the housing element update will go through the next 2 years. We have to have it in for HCD review by the fourth quarter of 2023. We're currently working on the multifamily objective standards. Ben Noble's under contract for that. But at the same time, we're going to work with our city attorney to draft up the single family objective standards for SB 9 to get that in place as soon as possible. So I'm going to show you this timeline. And that concludes our presentation. Wanted to have Layla here for any specific questions you may have about the new legislation.
I'm sure there may be a lot of them. Would anyone like to address a question to Layla?
This is Commissioner Wilk. I've got a question. You talked about remember which one it was, SC10 maybe, for the upzoning. And I'm trying to imagine, so there's this mall development thing where they were going to have 600 units, and there was some pushback on that. So if that was So we could zone that and say, okay, let's just put all of our RENA units like in that location, and that would cover it. We could just, you know, pick a spot and say, this is where we're going to cover this.
So within the RENA numbers, it's not just market rate units. It's broken down between very low, low, moderate, and above moderate. So if we were to say that all our RENA numbers were going to come from the mall development, then all of those units would have to be affordable if they were going to take that whole burden. So currently, I think with the mall development as proposed, it would have been about a little over, I think close to 100 units would have been affordable, so just like the 15% of the overall total. So.
Doesn't get us anywhere close.
No. We'll never get close.
I had a question.
Ed?
No, Mr. Layla, I seem to remember reading, it might have been SB9, I'm not sure, that there was some distinction drawn between cities of less than 50,000 and cities of more than 50,000 in terms of application of the statute.
That may have been in one of the earlier drafts, but SB9 applies to all cities as well as urbanized counties. Urbanized being sort of a vague definition from the census. So, but definitely all cities.
Okay, I'll have to go back at it again. That was in our packet somewhere, but I don't recall.
Oh, gotcha, okay.
Any other questions?
I have a question. In talking about the mall project, which is probably the biggest area where housing is going to be provided in Capitola, one of the real concerns up there is current traffic and the additional traffic that will be provided by this new development. So are you saying that there is no way any longer to require the development to deal with all of those?
Okay. Oh, Ms. Erica, it was just me. I think I heard most of the question. I can wait too, though.
Basically, I'm asking, can we require traffic improvements of the developer in areas where the development's going in and it's going to have a significant traffic impact? Or is that taken off the table now?
Well, you know, if the project does fall under SB9, which is, you know, a question in and of itself, then no, we would not be able to, you know, implement these kind of discretionary traffic analyses, right? But we would first have to figure out if we're even dealing with an SB9 project at all anyway. I'm not sure what the current zoning or the zoning will be of a mall project. I don't know if it's R1 or...
So it's regional commercial, and so the SB9 would not apply in our, because it will only apply to our R1 parcels. And the other thing that, in the review of the objective standards, it only applies when somebody brings in a complete new unit. So it will not affect how we look at additions to homes, but it will affect any new units that come in or these subdivision applications for two lots.
Okay, Katie, I have a question. On the upzoning to the 10 units per parcel, is there a definition as to how large that parcel has to be? Who determines that?
Layla, do you know if there is a requirement for size on SB10?
I don't believe so, off the top of my head, but I can double check. That would probably all be, you know, kind of hammered out in an ordinance that would be adopted, and I'm sure that that could specify, you know, minimum lot sizes as well. I'll have to double check with SB9.
Chair Ruth, that is, that's voluntary. The city does not have to follow SB 10. It just gives us the ability to adopt that ordinance if we'd like, so it's not required.
Okay. Any other questions for Layla while we have her here? Very none. Thank you, Layla, so much for the presentation.
Yes, thank you, Layla.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Commissioner. It's been a pleasure. Let me know if you have any other questions. My email will on the slideshow. So.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, that brings us to item B under public hearings tonight, which is the prototype ADU program.
Okay, we've got our workbench and meta designs team back, and I'm going to let them do introductions of y'all to meet them, and then I think Omar is going to lead the presentation.
Sure. Hi, everyone. Great to be back. I'll introduce myself. I'm Omar. I'm an architect at Workbench, and I'll let the rest of the team introduce themselves now. Alexandra, do you want to go next?
Hi, everyone. I'm Alexandra. I'm working with Omar on the design portion of the project.
I'm Jamili Cannon. I'm the founder of Workbench, and not really doing a lot, just letting Alexandra and Omar do some really excellent work and providing feedback.
And hi guys, I'm Sam Suter. I'm founder of Meta Urban Design, and I'm a sub-consultant to Workbench, and I'm dealing with the informational materials, which I'll talk more about in a moment.
Great, so that is the team, and I'm going to share my screen now. Bear with me for a second here. And if you could just let me know with a thumbs up, oops, if you can see my screen.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So.
It disappeared.
Yeah, I'm having some flickering here. Hang on one second. Let me try something.
There it is.
It says
you
started.
Yeah.
Okay.
There we go.
There's
a little lag, maybe.
There it is. Okay. Hopefully this works then. So.
Well, Omar, I'm only seeing pieces. Are you guys seeing that too?
Yeah.
Or
it's
blocked out?
It's just only the lower right hand corner.
I could try to share it from my computer if you'd like, Omar. I have it.
Right, sure. Let's try.
Should we try that? Is that better?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
All there.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Katie. If you want to go ahead and jump ahead a few slides. Today we're going to talk about the schematic design package completed for the Capital ADU program. And so if you want to skip ahead to one more slide there, perfect. So last time we met, we gave a little presentation about our process leading up to what you're seeing on the screen right now, which is the design for three unit types, which is a studio, a one bedroom, and a one bedroom plus, sometimes called a two bedroom, sort of a flexible unit on the end there. And you'll notice that we ended up with three versions of the studio, a small, medium, and large. And this was based on work with the city planners, Katie specifically, to identify buildable lot sizes, where we were trying to think of how to make these units most adaptable to most lots in Capitola. And so we presented these floor plans last time, which is the five floor plans, and we had identified three architectural styles, which is the Craftsman, the Farmhouse, and the Beach Bungalow. And last time we had shared that exterior design development for the one bedroom unit. And since then, we've gone through and completed completed the exercise for all of the floor plans you're seeing on the screen now. So we'll walk through that briefly and talk about some of the final tweaks we've made. You want to go to the next slide? Perfect. So this is the studio small. This is the smallest unit that we have. It is 10 feet wide by 25 feet, and it should fit on the majority of Capitola lots that could have an ADU in their backyard. On the, you'll see when you enter in the center of the unit, there is no circulation space. It is the most efficient, tightest plan of all. There is a bed area on the right with a full wall of full height storage, a small kitchenette directly in front of the door, and a bathroom, a full bathroom on the left side. For this unit, we're proposing that there is lofted storage over the bathroom area. And then you'll see on the left-hand side of the slide, the three architectural styles, which is the Craftsman, the Farmhouse, and the Beach Bungalow. Keep in mind, we're just showing exterior design notions on this. When people select these, they can obviously change the siding material, they can select colors that match their unit design and desires. And so these are just sort of inspirational images of the three styles that will be providing elevations and details. The studio medium is slightly larger, the 12 by 25. There's an added washer dryer at the bottom left-hand corner there. And you'll notice it's just a slightly larger, more livable unit for lots that are able to accommodate it. And then same thing again, the exterior designs are almost exactly the same on all of these studios, but just showing the sort of effect of the different material and palette and how you can achieve these different styles with very minimal changes to the actual building. And then the studio large is the largest of the studios. It's a 12 foot by 32 foot. In this one, we're able to actually accommodate a living space adjacent to that bed area. Could be a dining space, a little bit more flexible studio unit. The next one is a one bedroom. This is a true one bedroom with a dedicated built-in closet, space for a washer dryer, and a full bathroom. There's a full-size kitchen in this one with additional full-height storage and a living space that you enter off of a door that is sort of tucked around the corner to give some privacy to the ADU. Again, we're proposing some lofted storage over the bathroom and closet area of this unit. And you can see the exterior design is a little bit more articulated on this one. It really does feel like a small home, so we're really excited about how this one turned out. And you can see some of the differences between the different exterior styles more magnified in these larger units. And then the last one is the one bedroom plus, sometimes called a two bedroom. In this one, we're proposing sort of a flexible, longer living kitchen bar that could be used as an additional bedroom or could just be a larger living space for more flexible, larger living room, a dedicated dining room, perhaps a workspace. Really the idea here is to give people and homeowners the opportunity for maximum flexibility. And so now Alexander's gonna talk a little bit about what we're starting to do next and how we're organizing our drawing sets moving forward.
Great, thank you. So just want to quickly update everyone on where we are with our work in the schematic design phase, and along with doing all the work on the exteriors that Omar just spoke to, we're also starting to formulate our drawing set and do that in a way that is going to be the most user-friendly for homeowners that are taking advantage of the program. So what you're looking at here is just kind of a template for what we're working on for the main first shoot, which will have all the project information for homeowners. And the idea will be that a homeowner can take this first sheet, decide what style of ADU they want, decide what size of ADU they want, check the box. The box will say, hey, if you want a studio beach bungalow, you're gonna use sheet X, Y, Z. They'll put in their project information and a vicinity map, and then all information that the building department needs in order to review. I think next one. The other thing we're working on is we've put together beginnings of each architectural set. So this will be the first page, and we do have this. We don't have all of them to show you just for time, but we've done this for every size option and exterior style, starting to get out architectural sheets with exterior elevations. In the next phase of the project, we'll start to develop these further and really build it into construction documents.
All right. So for the informational materials, again, that's where my piece comes in. I want to explain how that fits with the larger Capitola ADU program. And so with the informational materials, we wanted to help residents, property owners understand, you know, what kinds of ADUs they can build, what lots, what resources are available. So this is probably a recap for a lot of you, but there are three levels of review for ADUs. The first layer, that's where workbenches, pre-designed plans come in. Those are all the ADUs under that threshold, that 800 square feet. Beyond that, there's the second layer of review, that's also administrative, and then there's the third level, which you guys are the experts on. So part of what the informational materials will do is to just explain those different buckets of review and explain the different criteria to help property owners understand which level of review they want to pursue and the rationale behind the different layers. So for instance, if they're just dealing with the size requirement, then they can understand the difference between the first layer review, second layer review. If they're deviating from the standards, then that's where they'll have to go and get planning commission review. So one of the major intentions behind the informational materials is just to explain that process and the different kind of choose your own adventure review process that property owners can go down. The second major intention of these informational materials is to just illustrate these standards. So even as I was explaining a different level of review, I was getting lost in all the different requirements. So a picture is worth a thousand words. That's really my expertise as a planner and a landscape architect. I really love illustrating regulations. So that's part of what I'm bringing to this team, is making sure that as we're explaining the different levels of review, we're also explaining what the standards are intending to support in the built environment. So you don't need an attorney or a planning degree to understand the standards. It can be really user-friendly and engaging. And so the graphic on the right is an example of work that I'm doing for Milpitas right now, very similar process. But I'll work closely with Workbench, so the whole package of materials will have a consistent look and feel, and will definitely be in the same graphic vocabulary. But that will be the next phase of this project, and I'm really excited to build off of Workbench's great plans and help you guys round out this ADU program.
Great. And so for next steps for us, our plan is to be complete with our work in Q1 of next year, and then our next checkpoint will be to go through the building plan review, where each of these drawing sets is reviewed by a plans examiner. And then hopefully we'll have a lovely functioning program for Capitola. I think that's all we've got, Katie.
Yeah, thank you, Mark. So yes, that is the next steps will be that the plans will be reviewed by our building department. And I just wanted to make sure that there's really no action that the planning commission needs to take on this item, but just that they've developed the plans that you were expecting based on the last review, and just to get your blessing to continue on.
I think you're doing a really, really good job, Omar and team. It looks really nice.
Could I have a question?
Commissioner Wilk?
Yes, thank you, Commissioner Ruth. So I was trying to imagine being an applicant. I would come in to the staff desk there and say, hey, I'm interested in the ADU. I want to look at this for sure. And the first question that would come to my mind after I got kind of excited about it, I'd say, well, do you have a rough idea of how much each of these are going to cost? Is there any thought of, you know, somehow ROMing the construction costs, say, based on 2021 construction construction cost, these will take, you know, whatever. Again, I would think that kind of thing would be really helpful, even if it was just a rough order of magnitude kind of a thing. Is there any thought about providing that kind of information, Katie?
You know, I don't think we have that included in our scope, but I think it's a great idea. Omar, is that something that is easily done within the workbench team, or is that?
I'll actually let Jamili speak to that.
We could definitely do that, Katie. I don't know if our fee on this one has enough in it, but if we get to the end and we have enough time left, I'd be happy to help with that. Yeah, construction pricing is not pretty right now, so hopefully it would change a lot in 2023 in the downward direction. So, you know, we could provide some pricing now and it will inevitably change, but we could at least give people some, you know, kind of ballpark figures that they'd be looking at. So, Katie, I'm happy to touch base with that later in the project and see.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I know it's not in our current scope, but I think it's a great idea.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Hearing none, then we'll move on. Thank you again, Omar, and your team.
Thank
you.
Thank you
all. Yeah,
thanks. Great. Thank you. Hey, Katie, do you have a director's report for us?
I do not have a director's report for you. This is it tonight.
Any commission communications? Mr. Newman.
Yeah, I want to get back to the date of the hearing here. The reason I knew that the date was incorrect when it was put up on the screen is because today's date is what's known as a palindrome, 12/02/2021. Reads forwards and backwards the same. So that's important for the commission to note.
Yeah, thank you for that little tidbit.
Thank you.
Any other questions or concerns, communications? Hearing none, then we'll adjourn to our January meeting. We'll be picking a new chairman at that time, chairperson. And happy holidays, everyone. Have a wonderful Christmas.
Thank you.
And we are